Welcome to Michigan, Laurie. This is her first time in Traverse City and her first time outside of Detroit. So we're happy to show you the bigger, brighter, whiter side of Michigan.
They asked me if I'd been to Michigan before, and I said, I think I was in Detroit. They said, that doesn't count.
And one of the first things she did after we arrived was take a picture of the snowfall to send to her grandson back in Santa Cruz. So we know at least one person was happy about the snow.
As it arrived, was having sunblock put on himself, so.
Oh, ouch. So even though the rest of us were not happy to see snow on April 6th, I know a lot of Laurie's fans were happy to see April 6th come because, as Doug said, this is just the second day that her latest book, The Murder of Mary Russell, is out. This is stop number 2 on her book tour. She was in Chicago last night, managed to get up here this morning, and is going on to St. Louis tomorrow. But for those who may not have read any of the Mary Russells yet, can you tell us a little bit, give us a little 101 Mary Russell, Sherlock Holmes, and a little bit about this particular book?
Mary Russell is a young female 20th century version of the great detective, therefore the vastly superior model.
Here's to that.
If there are any BSIs out there, I'm sorry, I got the stage. No, I was interested in the idea of, if you have a mind as a sort of an element of itself, could you take that mind and put it into a different housing, as it were, so that instead of being a middle-aged Victorian male detective, what would that mind look like if it were in a young woman? So The Beekeeper's Apprentice was my first exploration into this, looking at, it's a sort of coming of age story, really. She's 15 when we meet her, and I think it ends when she's 19. And it's the idea that if you have two similar things, it's always more fascinating to put them near each other rather than separate them out. I mean, Russell could as easily have been a detective in San Francisco in 1987. But I thought, if she is patterned on Holmes, wouldn't it be more interesting to put the two of them together? Mm-hmm. And indeed, it seems to have turned out that way.
It seems to have, yes. Over the course of 14 novels, They've matured from mere partners, partners in crime, partners in investigation, to partners in life.
Yes.
And then the current novel starts in 1925, but quickly reels the reader back in time to the point of view of another character.
Yes, this book started with my editor saying to me in a conversation, asking me if I'd ever thought of killing off my character. Which I thought, you know, if the editor says that, there must be a reason behind it. So I thought it would be really interesting to tell what is, yes, it's a Russell story, but it is also the story of how all of the history that is embodied in Sherlock Holmes confronts her. I mean, this the death that comes to meet her is none of her doing. It's all because of actions that started in 1855. And so the bulk of the story is the story of Mrs. Hudson. It's the good old housekeeper in Sussex, that I make her the housekeeper, but she's the landlady of Baker Street. And I mean, she's always been a fascinating character because on the one hand, she's relegated to the position of the lady who keeps the maids working and brings pots of tea and tells Holmes that there's a visitor at the door and makes noises of despair as the little street urchins that he hires to do his jobs come racing through her clean rooms. But she's also this woman who, for one thing, put up with him for all those years without throwing him out or murdering him. Which alone makes her an interesting character in my mind. And she's also, in one of the stories, he has her crawling around on the carpeting, shifting a wax bust against a curtain so that it looks like he's just sitting and reading and occasionally changes position. Yeah. There's a man across the way with a gun that she's crawling around on the floor, and he just says, "Oh, yes, you don't mind doing this, do you, Mrs. Hudson?" And she says, "Oh, of course not." Honestly, what landlady would do that?
Yeah.
So this was the sort of fascination that I had with this character of what was their relationship? You know, when Russell meets him in 1915 during the Great War, the two of them, the housekeeper and the detective, had known each other for going on 35, 36 years. And I thought, this is a history I needed to look at. Yeah. So that's where she comes from.
Right, right. And you were able to fully imagine that new character, that Mrs. Hudson, in this book.
Yes.
Yes, okay. Now, we're going to be very careful not to give away any endings here, so you'll notice that. But I want to hearken back to the scholarship awards just a minute ago. It's kind of an interesting coincidence that you happen to be here tonight, since you never received that kind of encouragement as a young person yourself for your own writing. You didn't start writing your novels until your 30s. Can you tell us how that came about?
I don't know. I remember a paper that my mother saved from a high school class.
Okay.
That was about crossing the Golden Gate Bridge. And the teacher very clearly wrote an A on it and said, "You should be a writer."
Okay, all right. That's important.
It took me another, 25 years to get there, but that's okay. Yeah, I didn't start writing until I was in my 30s. I was one of those kids that always goes in libraries and I mean, really, you'd live in libraries. And I don't think I'd ever actually met a writer. If you've never met one of the species, you don't believe in them. I mean, I probably believed in unicorns more easily because I at least saw those in my imagination. Mm-hmm. But the idea of someone writing a book and these things that were on the shelves in the library, surely God put them there, right?
Uh-huh.
Or they spontaneously generated overnight or something. But I didn't know anyone. So it took me until I was in my 30s before I thought, maybe I could tell a story. I think it's fairly common among crime writers to have a career or a life that you then, because you've spent your life reading, you learn the language of storytelling in a way that, I never took classes in writing after high school or whatever. And I think that my kind of storytelling is the sort of, it's like when you go to a foreign country to learn a language, you absorb it bit by bit rather than memorizing the verb forms and the vocabulary and the endings. Mm-hmm. You learn how it works naturally, and that's my kind of writing.
That's your kind of writing.
Which means that I'm reinventing the wheel all the time. I had this really clever thing I did in a book, and I thought, boy, this is really clever. And I learned that it was called foreshadowing, and everyone does it. Yeah.
It was much easier the second time.
Yeah, the second time it was remarkably easier.
Yeah, it was around. So you decide to try your hand at writing a book in your 30s, and you decide, maybe I'll aim low, and I'll go for one of the most beloved characters in all of literature in Sherlock Holmes and, of course, Mary Russell. And I think maybe some readers wonder, how does it work? How are you able, as an author unto yourself, to use characters that someone else originated and put them into your own stories and dream up their own subsequent adventures?
Oh, I suppose it must have been a kind of fan fiction in my own head.
Uh-huh.
I did not read the Holmes stories. Everybody reads what is the speckled band and Hound of the Baskervilles in high school and whatever the assignments were. So I knew who wrote them anyway. But I hadn't read the stories until I sat down to write. I was 15 when I first met Sherlock Holmes and thought, oh dear, I don't know anything about Sherlock Holmes. So I then had to read my way through the stories, which was a very interesting experience because coming to those tales as an adult, you see things in them that's very different from what you expect. I mean, everybody knows the Holmes stories, right? Thinking machine, Dr. Watson a little stupid, in fact, there's a texture to the stories that I had not anticipated. There's humor in them, believe it or not. There's a sense that Holmes is not just a thinking machine who likes to be clever and to work out puzzles. He's a man who is driven by the passion for justice. And how you write that in a story without writing it, I found fascinating. I mean, mm-hmm. Conan Doyle is a very spare writer. He doesn't waste words on things like emotions, but they're there. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it was an interesting experience reading through them.
Yeah, you found them to be, it was showing, not telling, as one of the cardinal rules.
Yeah, yeah, and even more than that, he's showing one thing, but you get a sense of the other.
Okay.
I mean, he's showing you a man who is above emotional attachment, and yet he has a man who will lay his life down for him, Dr. Watson. He has a woman who will crawl on the floor with bullets flying over his head, who he ignores most of the time. And that's not a person who is apart from human beings.
Mm-hmm. And speaking of that, doing something, not in so many words, but conveying a sense or a feeling to the reader. I felt that was something you did very well with Holmes and Russell. In your bio on your website, it says, Holmes and Russell exist in a state of amiable discord. And yes. That's true, but I also picked up a very tender note between the two of them.
Oh, don't tell him that.
Yeah. And again, it wasn't what they were saying necessarily to each other, but the gestures and how they passed and the fact that he wouldn't sleep out of concern. And I felt that you showed that very well.
Yeah, there's some interesting sections in this book that were tricky to write because, again, without giving away spoilers, he finds evidence that she is dead, and he has to deal with this. And anyone who doesn't easily contact their emotions internally doesn't know how to deal with it when they do well up. And so they displace into, you have to have a scientific experiment to figure stuff out, and you have to get in your car and drive somewhere and figure something out and interview someone and just shake them until you know what's going on. Mm-hmm. And that kind of reaction to trauma in a man who normally is so very, very controlled, mm-hmm. is an interesting thing to write.
Yeah. Okay. And this, of course, as we said, is a historical series. You have a contemporary detective series as well, also for sale, I believe.
Oh.
this one is historical. Yeah. And you said today something interesting. One of the bonuses of reading historical fiction is that you learn something. And so I wonder if you could share with us something that you found fascinating in the course of researching and writing The Murder of Mary Russell.
Oh, it was... I've normally lived... In fiction terms, in the 20s for quite a while. But this one has elements that, as I said, begin in 1855, and they follow Clarissa Hudson, as she is then, and in through the 60s and 70s as she's coming of age. And I was fascinated with all the women's clothing, for one thing. I mean, you know, we tend to sort of ignore what we're wearing unless we have 4-inch heels on. But the woman's clothing in Victorian times was like this exoskeleton that defined her. It shaped her, it made her aware of herself, it made people aware of her in a way that modern clothing does not. I mean, modern clothing is something we wear to put on when we go out. Mm-hmm. But the definition, the literal definition of the body by women's clothing was fascinating. And the way that it changes, and the hazards of it. I mean, they had this fire in Santiago in Chile where women raced for the door in a church and their hoop skirts got caught and they couldn't get out. And so people died, a huge number of people died because of the hoop skirts. Hmm. You know, I mean, the sort of the dangers of bunions are nothing compared with that.
Well, there,
you notice that I don't wear heels, so I...
And one of the scenes with Mrs. Hudson, she has a baby, and there's a reference to a nursing corset.
Oh, yeah.
That's quite a notion.
Google the words nursing corset, you guys. It's really interesting.
Yeah, I can't imagine. Can't imagine wearing that.
No.
Okay.
But the whole, I mean, a woman, and I think we have a lot of this in our television programs recently, Downton Abbey and the rest of it, that a woman through Victorian times was defined by her relationship with men, who her father was, what her brothers did, and who she was eventually married to. And a woman without a man was definitely not a fish without a bicycle. A woman without a man in Victorian times was alone, terrifyingly alone. And for anyone, the workhouse loomed. And the workhouse was a terrible, terrible place to end up. And so how a woman such as Clara Hudson could shape a life for herself that was apart from the various men in her life was one of the things that I was interested in exploring in the story.
Mm-hmm. Doug mentioned in the introduction your interest in feminism, and that comes out certainly in Russell as a feminist character, but Mrs. Hudson too, even if the path she had to choose wasn't perhaps the most savory at first.
It was a creative path.
Yeah.
I think I don't know about unsavory. I think it's a path that's defined by necessity.
Right. She made her own decisions and what she was going to do, and she decided what was the lesser of two evils.
Yes.
Perhaps.
Yes. The great Sherlockian reference is the Irene Adler and the adventuress. I mean, she was an adventuress, which I always wanted to join the adventuresses of Sherlock Holmes. Don't you think it would be fun to be an adventuress?
Yes, it would. And you are somewhat of an adventuress, and your own travels have informed a lot of the books. A substantial part of The Murder of Mary Russell occurs in Australia, where it turns out Mrs. Hudson is from. So can you talk a little bit about that, about your travels and, you know, how you rely? Does an idea come up, oh, I should set a scene here, or how does that work?
Yeah, I tend not to write about places that I haven't at least driven through by daylight.
I understand.
There's academic rigor, you understand. So I tend to go to places knowing that I want to write about them. Sometimes places will take me by surprise. I happened to go to Morocco because I was staying with family in Lisbon, and we wanted a place that we could go to for 10 days that didn't involve a stop in Madrid. And so we had southern France or northern Africa. So we chose Morocco, and I had a scene in one of the books. I was then writing a book called Pirate King, and I had a scene in a town that's on the coast, and I thought, well, this justifies, I mean, writers justify their travel by taking it off on taxes, right? So I thought, if I write a scene set in here, I can take off the full 10 days, right? Because I have to be there. And so I did this, and it was like a one-day trip to Salah and Rabé. And we then went up to Fez, and I absolutely fell in love with the city. It was such a fascinating place. I had no expectation of writing a book setting there. But it just seized my imagination in a way that I had not expected. And so I thought, if ever I write a book with that cliche of romance fiction, the woman who wakes up with amnesia, this is the place to do it. Because it's completely confusing even if you know who you are and what you're doing there.
Yeah. So. Yeah, and she does.
Yes.
Okay.
Poor Russell, I'm so mean to her.
Oh, I think she's doing pretty well. I think she's doing pretty well.
She hasn't
well.
Lost a limb yet. I mean,
a few scars.
Yeah.
A few scars.
It's one of the reasons why I tend to alternate books, because I find that after I write a series of, if I've lived with someone for too long, I tend to want to hurt them.
Uh-huh. Okay. Yeah.
So my husband traveled a lot on his own. but you do tend to find that after three or four Russell books, she tends to get concussions and, you know, major bruises and knife cuts and things. At that point, my editor says, I think it's time you looked at something else next year. Yeah.
Okay.
All right. We don't know each other well enough. It's all right. You're safe.
Oh, we were sitting next to each other at a couple meals today with knives on the table and things like that.
I would have chosen
another seat. On the adventurous note, too, there are what we were discussing in the green room as far as approaches to writing fiction, what I was calling the plotter camp, people who outline what they're going to do and they have character sketches and they know the ending when they start the beginning, and the pantser camp, which are writers who write by the seat of their pants. And you had another pair of terms for that, but you're in the latter, but tell us how you describe your own process.
Yeah, a friend and I wrote a book, collaborated on a book on crime and thriller writing. And she is a devout outliner, and I am a devout non. And so we each wrote a section and then shared it to sort of see how we were going forward. And she basically said, anyone who doesn't outline is a fool. And I basically said, anyone who outlines is so anal, I can't believe it.
Yeah.
And so we realized this was perhaps not the exact approach for this book. And so we smoothed it down and we called ourselves the organized writer, which was her, and the organic writer, which was me. So I thought that was much easier to explain. Because I think that it is a lot of how you are comfortable writing. Mm-hmm. Some people can produce a very detailed outline and not feel confined by it. I can't. I find that some books require a certain amount of outlining because you have pieces that need to follow each other. But for the most part, I'd really rather write the book. Mm-hmm. Having said that, there is something in the back of my head that is keeping track of the order of events. Mm-hmm. Because I find that there are certain points that I will... I don't get writer's block, but what I want to do is go clean the oven and clear the closets. Mm-hmm. And that's really serious.
Yeah.
So if I find myself wanting to do something that badly other than write, I find that if I step back and reread what I have, I have been writing myself into a corner without realizing it.
Okay.
And so at that point, you know, the back of my head says, whoa, stop before you get there.
Okay.
And so there's an organized person in the back of my head who puts the brakes on if I get too out of hand.
Yeah. But. And so what happens then if you find yourself backed into a corner? Do you dig a hole to find a way out?
Almost always. Yeah. What I will find is, as I go back, I will find a hook that I can work the necessary, you know, plot or subplot or characterization or something onto. I mean, it's almost always there, that just waiting for me to use it later on.
Right, 50 and to be able to see it.
Yeah, yeah. If I'm looking for it, I can find it.
Okay, okay. Even if your head is in the oven.
Yeah, yeah. Head's in the oven.
Yeah, maybe that's an idea for future. I don't know. Did they have that in Mary Russell's age?
Oh, you used to do blacking your stove.
Okay.
I mean, you know, the maid would do it. You wouldn't do it yourself. But yeah, a stove had to be blacked daily. God, what a job.
Yeah. Oh, terrible. Okay. So in the writing process for The Murder of Mary Russell, did you find yourself at certain decision? Did it start out with you knowing that Mrs. Hudson was going to be such a significant part of it, or?
Yeah. Yeah. I knew that if I murdered Mary Russell, somebody had to pick up the reins.
Mm-hmm.
And I had always been interested in Mrs. Hudson. And in fact, I wrote a short story about her a number of years ago called Mrs. Hudson's Case, that she presents a case to Sherlock Holmes, who's far too busy. And so she says, okay, I'll do it. too right. But yeah, I had wanted to write about the woman. And to explore the Victorian times, and also it enabled me to look at Holmes himself when he's younger. I mean, when you first meet Sherlock Holmes in the Conan Doyle stories, we tend to think of him as a middle-aged man, because all of the images of him show a middle-aged man from the beginning. Edward Paget, who did a lot of the early artwork, used his older brother as the model, who was a balding man with a big nose. And so, thin, he was thin. Mm-hmm. And so so we tend to think of Sherlock Holmes as being at least in his 30s from the beginning. But in fact, when you meet him at the very beginning, Watson thinks he's an undergraduate, because he's working in the laboratory at St. Bart's Hospital, which is, you know, where an undergraduate would have done a certain amount of work. And that's 17, 18? I mean, an undergraduate in British terms is not, I mean, ours tend to be 18 to 22.
Mm-hmm.
But in British terms, and especially at the time, if you were bright, you were in college at 16.
Hmm.
So that means he was a boy. This is a child that we're dealing with when we first meet him. Which is, a whole different take on Sherlock Holmes.
Right.
And I had established his chronology early, because there's huge debates on all aspects of the Sherlock Holmes stories.
Yeah.
Anything that you could possibly wonder about, somebody's written an article on it. And one of those is when he was born, because Conan Doyle never bothered telling anything about him. I mean, he never took Sherlock Holmes seriously, for one thing, and he wasn't interested in writing that kind of history. He was just writing stories.
Right.
And so I make him slightly younger than a lot of people think, because I base it on a couple of the stories.
Okay.
And it's backed up by the fact that when you first meet him, and when Dr. Watson first meets him, he's this undergraduate. So.
And you've spent quite a number of years in university as well yourself, and you met your husband there, and you do a lot of research at the University of California, Santa Cruz Library, you were saying?
Yes, yes, they love me there because I ask for things nobody else ever does.
Can you talk a little bit about that, about how your own academic background and in your personal life, you know, maybe influences your writing and the themes that you bring forth?
Yeah, my background is, as you mentioned, academic, and it's specifically theology. I did a I did a bachelor's degree in religious studies, and went on to do a master's in Old Testament. And I think that probably a third or so of the novels that I've done have some aspect of religion or theology in them. Mm-hmm. In one of them, Russell works with a woman who runs a women's shelter and is a sort of, kind of Amy Semple McPherson type, except without the corruption. Mm-hmm. And in others, there's, you know, there's various theological elements in there. And I think that it enables me to get into the character in a way that that is different. And it's, I always aim for a balance between people writing me and saying, yeah, the theology was okay, but I can skip over it. And people who write and say, I really wish you'd done more theology. So I said, if you get the equal number of letters, you fit this sort of down the middle. So,
right, down the middle sweet spot.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. And there's an e-short that was also released about a month ago in advance of this, The Marriage of Mary Russell. And
got it. It's really clever. Marriage, murder.
Mm-hmm. and I believe they do, but Mary Russell is Jewish. And
yes, her mother was Jewish, which makes her Jewish. Her father was Christian.
Yeah, and they have a Christian wedding, correct?
Is more or less,
justice of the peace kind of thing? Okay, all right. So, I believe you said that this is the second time you've done this kind of an ebook connection to your novel.
Yeah.
Is that your idea? Is that the publisher's idea? You know, how do those things work together?
Oh yes, the publishers have all kinds of ideas they'd like us to do. It's again one of those conversations with the editor when they say. One of the drawbacks of having a series that's going on for 10, 12, 15 books is that a lot of people think, well, I can't pick it up now because I haven't read the first dozen of them.
Right.
Which is, I think in the books is never, there's one book that was paired so heavily with the previous book that it would make sense. The God of the Hive does make sense to read the previous one. But for the most part, you don't need to know, and especially with something like this, which is, I mean, she dies in the first chapter anyway. Who cares? I think they were interested in a way of teasing people into the book by having a story that sort of plays on the same themes. Mm-hmm. And so, since it was something I'd been thinking of for a long time anyway, is writing the marriage. There's a Mary Russell, it's a whole Mary Russell community out there, which I'm sure surprises all of you. And some of them do fan fiction. There's a fan fiction site.
Really?
Early on, I had two or three people send me pieces that they'd written about Mary Russell and Sherlock Holmes. Mm-hmm. And I quickly saw that there was going to be an unhealthy interest in the wedding night.
Ah, yeah.
At that point, I stopped reading the fan fiction.
Uh-huh.
And said in my very best Russell voice, kindly grant us my privacy. So, I always wanted to write about the marriage itself because I thought that would be an interesting beginning. You have the one book ends with their deciding that they really need to get married, rather dramatically. You know, she thinks he's dead, and anyway, and the next book starts 3 years later, when they're this old married couple. So you sort of need to know something of how they got there, and I at some point I can fill in. I got 3 years there; I can fill in. So even if she's dead now, I can go back, right?
Yeah.
Just dust her off a little. But I thought a marriage would be fun, and then especially because this book is about Mrs. Hudson, I wanted her to play a part in the in the wedding. And I also enjoy writing the humor in the books. Mm-hmm. And I thought, well, if I can't write a funny marriage scene, I don't know what I can do. So yeah, so I got to write some bits of humor into it.
Well, I hope you never do indulge that request for the wedding night, because that would release the tension there.
And well, that's sort of what wedding nights are about.
But for the readers, and
sorry,
but for the readers, it would.
She really didn't know what to expect when she asked me this question.
I went out of limb.
No, I think that I think that you're when you're dealing with a short story like this, you're wanting to encapsulate an entire part of the personality of the character, and that's what a short piece is about. It's a novel is something that even if you're taking a day off work, it's a long time. But a short story is meant to be a little gift, and it's mm-hmm. just there and self-contained. But I did have to change when they first sent, the publishers do what they call cover copy, and even for a short story like this, it's a cover copy, which is a description. And it's usually got the first two or three lines as a sort of trumpet blow, and isn't this exciting, and then it goes on and spends a couple paragraphs talking about it. So their cover copy ends, it's something about, this is the most dangerous case in their career, their wedding. And the copy art editor put the word night in there. So the most dangerous case in their career, their wedding night, just didn't have the same ring to it.
Yeah, no,
So I thought, can we just leave that word off? Yeah. And so, yes, but.
Okay.
So moving right along.
The fan fiction, I was interested to hear about that. And I've been reading your blog and following along since I knew I was going to be interviewing tonight. And one of the things that you just released the other day was the winner of the Mary Russell obituary contest. And there were, I don't know how many entries.
Oh, my editor had such fun. She said, "Ah, oh, I'm just so bad."
Yeah. Well, and I wonder, does that either through the fan fiction or contests like that or other contact with your readers, who seem, certainly a very devoted band, and I'm sure there's some out in the audience here tonight. Do you get ideas whether they're just details or scenes or, something that's, for a file for a future book from readers?
I don't remember ever having stolen somebody's idea outright. Every so often I'll give something to one of my kind of beta readers. I have two or three people who work very closely with me on various things, and I'll give it to them. And they'll have some response that either they or my editor will have some response that will make me realize in my interest of getting plot, that I'd forgotten the emotional or some kind of character development that I'd left out. Mm-hmm. And so that sometimes is very helpful. Well, somebody will say, I kind of had wished for a little more of this, and I think, yes, it needs that. So yeah, mm-hmm. readers are helpful. I'm not somebody who could make a terribly successful career as a self-published writer, because mm-hmm. I really require the feedback of a good trained eye. Mm-hmm. And I work very closely with my editor. And
over your whole career,
yeah,
you said, which is very unusual.
She hasn't been my main editor since the beginning, but she's been with me since very early on. So and she has a very deadly pencil when it comes to her edits.
And this was the one who also suggested that you consider killing off Mary Russell?
She just asked the simple question.
Asked the simple question.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Knowing full well what it would do to my poor little fevered brain.
Well, and another thing that you mentioned over the course of the day is, as we've said, this novel goes into great detail on Mrs. Hudson. You said you came to be quite fond of Mrs. Hudson. in the course of that.
Yeah, I like Mrs. Hudson a lot. In fact, I think that Mrs. Hudson would indeed make a very interesting series, either during her youth, or I've often thought it would be fun to write an older woman as a protagonist. You know, when you see the end of her in this book, she's 70. She's nearly 70. And being 63 myself, I sort of think 70 is an interesting age. Mm-hmm. So.
Well, I wonder if I might ask you to read a little bit from the book before we move into the question and answer period.
Sure. It's always difficult to read something that isn't the first three pages of a book or that gives spoilers, but I will do some. Do you want me to read here or there? Does it matter to you?
It's fine with me. If everyone can hear fine from the chair. So
sorry,
stay seated.
Change my glasses. So as I said, the book follows Clara Hudson's life, and eventually she meets Sherlock Holmes, which I'm not going to read you that section, but I think I can safely read you a section where she meets 221 Baker Street. So they are in a hansom cab, which if you've ever seen any of the old Sherlock Holmes things, is that little thing that's very tall, has two wheels, and it's about this wide. So she's in it with him. The cab bumped along the stones of Southwark to the river, then across, making in the direction of Regent's Park. The interior was remarkably full, what with her skirts and the silk hat upon his knees. The hat juddered up and down. Not, she noticed, in time with the wheels. No, his left leg was jumping a rapid rhythm. She glanced at his face. He did not look in the least nervous, merely impatient. She'd seen that kind of jitter in neighbors over the years, men and women who indulged in certain chemicals. Were his purple, was pupils perhaps larger than usual? He turned, feeling her gaze. Is something the matter? No, I was just wondering. Yes. It was too dark to tell inside the cab. Are you still in university then? He turned his face forward. Not anymore. What do you do? Gentlemen tended not to do much, but this one was hardly of the usual run of gentlemen. His narrow mouth twitched. One might say I have been finding my vocation. How nice, and what vocation have you found? Detective. She recoiled as far as possible in their crowded confines. You're a policeman? He gave a scornful swipe of the hand. Certainly not. The limitations would stifle. I shall turn my skills to those problems the police are baffled by or unable to address. A private inquiry agent, then. Of a sort. To spend one's days investigating cases of fraud, missing children, and illicit love affairs didn't sound appealing to her. Perhaps his was a boy's own sort of romance. Like Mr. Poe's stories? Dupin, he scoffed. Showy tales, lacking in substance. In fact, when she'd read that orangutan story of Poe's to Billy, they had agreed that Monsieur Dupin's abilities were remarkable, but she wouldn't argue the point with a man of such conviction as Mr. Sherlock Holmes. Instead, she nodded thoughtfully, a sort of consulting detective then. Are there many of those? So far as I know, I am unique. Thank the heavens for that, she thought fervently, and let the rest of the ride pass in silence. After a time, the horse turned along a row of terrace buildings, the upper stories brick with shop fronts or stone faces on the street level. The hooves clopped to a halt before number 221. Holmes tossed the driver a coin and helped Clarissa down from the cab, fishing in his pockets as he trotted up the front steps. The house was clearly empty, had been for some time to judge by the condition of the paint around its windows, but the lock mechanism worked smoothly. Inside lay cracked floor tiles, dusty cobwebs, and buckling wallpaper that had known the touch of many greasy hands. A half-window door missing its glass was tucked behind the stairs. On its upper rail, a tarnished brass A dangled from a surviving screw. Mr. Holmes stepped forward to open the door to apartment A, pressing his back against the wall as invitation. She gathered her skirts and pressed around him, but rather than follow, he retreated to continue up the stairs. She watched his polished boots disappear, then turned her jaundiced eye to the rooms that composed 221A Baker Street. Every inch of it wanted carbolic, plaster, paint, and fresh paper. Any attempt to kindle heat would burn the place down. However, once the surface decay had been banished and the flues entirely rebuilt, she imagined the kitchen, pantry, and small sitting area would be comfortable enough. She closed the door and started up the stairs, testing each before committing her weight to it. On the next floor up, flat B didn't even have a letter, merely two holes in a door leaning against the wall. Through the empty doorframe lay a potentially comfortable suite consisting of two spacious bedrooms at the back and a large sitting room at the front. In this latter, a pair of stingy windows looked ready to dive into the street. The floorboards were bare, apart from the dust and droppings of vermin. The wood so badly gouged and scraped it looked as if a pony with loose shoe nails had been stabled here. The sound of pigeons came from above, and not, she thought uneasily, from out of doors. Clarissa studied a twisted length of gas pipe protruding from the wall, wondering how much force was required to break a light fixture away like that. Is the house yours? No, I have no wish to take on the burdens of householder. His voice echoed from the next room, followed by the ominous thumps and trickle of falling plasters. Good thing, she said.
All right, thank you. Well, right now we asked if we could bring the lights up a little bit, and there are roving microphone holders in the audience.
Well, there are people out there. Hi.
Hi. I have two questions. One, it's like the tone and the voice of the Bones of Paris is so different from the Mary Russell books. How do you keep a consistent tone throughout the different kinds of books? And two, is Leigh Richards ever going to have time to write another book?
Yes. I kind of wish that. Now, did you all hear that? Is that okay? To answer the second one first, I haven't any plans for another Leigh Richards, Califia's daughter story. I would like to. If I live long enough, many of these things will get done. Voice is an interesting thing, isn't it, with books. How I managed to come up with Mary Russell's voice from the beginning that was so very distinctive and so impossible for me to step out of, I'm not sure. But it's true, the other books that I do are very different in their flavor. Even the Martinellis, which part of it is that it's the difference between first and third person, because the Russells are all written in first person, I. And the others are mostly third. And it's somehow easier to focus when you're talking in third person on the people that you're looking at. The Stuyvesant and Grey series are, although they're historicals, they are very interesting because I wanted to write boy books. I wanted to write about these male characters. The main character, the protagonist, is a man. He has two people that he regularly has in the series. One is a woman, but the other is a man. And I started writing each one by reading my way through all the boy books. I mean, I went through Lee Child's and Bob Kreis, and I started swaggering as I was writing, and then I'd start writing and, you know, carry on in that vein. Because it needed to have that kind of very masculine presence, somebody to whom a fistfight would be rather more natural than it is to me.
Balcony. Another question? Balcony?
Yeah, right here.
On the right.
Has the subject ever come up between Russell and Holmes of Irene Adler?
I think Irene Adler is a kind of subtext in a lot of the Russell adventures. Yeah. It's mentioned at various points, but it's only when Holmes's son with Irene Adler appears on the scene that it really comes front and center. So yeah, in the Language of Bees, you meet the result of his liaison with the adventurous contralto Irene Adler. There's a lot of mentions in the Russell stories about the idea that you walk into a conversation that's been going on for a while. This is something that I personally knew well because my husband was 30 years older than I was, and so I was often aware when he, you know, would talk with friends. I was often aware that I hadn't been there for the first 20 years of this friendship. And I think that that's one of the places where I think the Russell stories are somewhat personal, of the sense that you are the junior partner in the firm, and the more experienced partner is somebody who has a lot of resources you don't. So yeah, it's an ongoing. Only somebody like Mary Russell can keep up with somebody like Holmes, and I think she manages somehow.
Another balcony way over, and also next down in the front again.
Hi. To me, it feels like your books really led off or kicked off this resurgence in interest in Sherlock Holmes, and in particular, people grabbing onto this character and making him their own, with the Robert Downey Jr. version now and the Cumberbatch version, and of course, the one that's on in CBS. And more recently and more closely linked, it feels a little bit to me, to your characters and story, Holmes, the movie that just came out, where Holmes meets a young person bonding over beekeeping. I wanted to kind of find out what you think of that, and do you follow all of these other adaptations?
Yeah, I think there's been the Holmes world tends to sort of come and go in waves, I think, and we're at a peak at the moment, and we'll all. I mean, in 20 years, nobody will read Mary Russell because she's so old hat, right? But it is interesting that I came in. I wasn't at really the beginning, but it was midway. Part of it was that various court decisions have meant that people can now write the Holmes stuff without violating copyright. But I think. People are really interested in that kind of crime story. That is, we're not talking Superman. We're talking about a human being who can affect change in the world in a way that is both real and fabulous. That I think that's why we read crime fiction to begin with, and why we see movies and television programs about crime. Is that it enables us to think that maybe, if we do something right, we can set something aright again. If we only knew how to handle things, we could restore some order to the universe. And I think that Holmes does that in a way that that more physical heroes don't.
Thank you.
Two comments, please. First off, I think you loved Mrs. Hudson, perhaps before you knew you did. I love, in the first book, I love how she senses immediately that Mary is hungry. And at the very, very end of the book, when Mary comes down from the hill after having her good cry, and the comforting words at the very end of the book where she walks into the cottage where they spell tobacco, food, and whatever it was. I can't remember the last word, but that was so lovely. And it made me love Mrs. Hudson from the beginning. Secondly, I have just laughed and laughed as I've read it more than once. Your comment about outside characters like Tolkien and Dashiell Hammett. That was funny. Thank you.
Yeah, it's when I set a book in a place or a time, one of the first things I try and figure out is who was going to be there at the time. So I was really pleased when my chronology put them in San Francisco at a given time, and I discovered that Dashiell Hammett was going to be in town. So I could borrow Dashiell Hammett and make him part of Locked Rooms. The corollary to that is, if any of you are thinking of doing this as work of your own, I would suggest that you either get somebody who's dead, really dead, and preferably who didn't have children, because not that there was any problem with it, but I had written this book, and there was a thing up in San Francisco. I saw a notice that they were dedicating Dashiell Hammett's one of his apartments, his flat. I think it was the one on Post Street. And so I knew slightly the man who was going to be in charge of this thing, and I wrote him a note and said, funnily enough, I've just written a book with Dashiell Hammett as one of the characters. So he wrote back and said, oh, you must come to lunch. We're having Dashiell Hammett's daughter and granddaughter. And I thought, oh, wait a minute. This is my fictional character, and he's got real life. My head kind of went, woo. So I did end up going up there, and I did give his daughter, who was in her 80s then, a copy of the advanced reading edition. But I didn't go to lunch because I just thought that would just be so bizarre. I couldn't handle it. So I handed her this thing, and she's this little tiny gray-haired lady. And I said, I'm awfully sorry I borrowed your father for an adventure. And she said, oh, that's all right, dear. People have done worse. So after that, I was kind of careful about, they may have kids. I mean, like General Allenby might have kids, but I don't know them. So.
Okay.
It's all right.
We have one more question.
Okay.
Yep. Two questions, actually. First, which is your favorite Russell story and why? And secondly, what are your favorite elements of her character or personality?
Which of my children do I love best? I generally speaking, I love the one that I haven't written yet because it's just so fabulous. But I think that, I mean, there's things about various books that I love. I mean, I'm very fond of Locked Rooms because it's not only complicated and it shows her as a flawed person, but it also has San Francisco in it, which was a lot of fun to write. The Beekeeper's Apprentice, I always will be very fond of because it was the beginning, and I think you can see a lot of very interesting energies in that book that quite often with a writer, you find that they never again in their entire career have as much time to spend on a book as their first one. So the first one is where they put everything, which sometimes can be bad and sometimes can be good. So I think that there's a lot of that going on in Beekeeper. As for what I like best about Russell, one of the real advantages of writing fiction is that you can always have a quick comeback, even if it takes you 6 weeks of writing to get there. Russell is just so whip smart that there's a lot of work in that whip smart. But yeah, it's fascinating. Some of writing in her voice, and I'm not one of those people who instantly has a comeback. I mean, I usually, like most people, the next day I think I should have said anything. But quite often with Russell, the conversation will be going along and I'll know exactly the kind of clever phrase that she should use. So she's much brighter than I am.
I think we may have time for about one more. Then before you go, Laurie has a request of the audience. Yes, sir, over here.
Okay, if you had, as a relatively successful, obviously, writer, what would be a piece of advice you would say to our young writers that we heard tonight?
Two pieces of advice. Can I have two? Is that okay? One of them is read. I think that there's no schooling, no classes, no training that can do more for you as a writer than reading. Read broadly, read everything, read with joy, read with a critical eye if you must, but read. and the other is write. One of the things that I see often in the writing world, and especially now that we're getting into self-publishing, is that people will write a book and they will become so fixed on that book, either selling it or marketing it or fixing it or making it better or putting a cover on it, or that they are the author of a book. They are not a writer. Because of writing is a career, and it's a lifelong commitment to putting words on a page. They're bad words. When you first put words on a page, they're awful words. They make no sense. They're the wrong words. They're clumsy. They're pointless. But if they're not on a page, you can't make them any better. And so when you are writing, you have to keep writing, even if you're also doing the other stuff of publishing and formatting and putting it online and promoting. But if that gets in the way of your writing, then drop it and be a writer. It's better to starve than, oh.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. All right, well, Laurie's request before you all depart is, she wants to take a picture.
Yeah, you have to set the camera.
Okay, yes.
I left my phone on the charger. I'm really sorry. But I promised that I would post pictures on my Facebook author page. So you guys are going to be on my Facebook author page. So, okay? Everybody say, Russell!
You want me to take one of you in it?
Oh, no. You don't need one of
Are you sure?
But thank you all. This has been lovely.
Thank you.